There it is. We're live.
I'm playing. I'm hitting play. Is it not?
It played for half a second and then.
This is not working out for us. Okay, I got it.
There was an idea. The idea was to bring together a group of remarkable people. See if they could become something more.
I have an army.
We have a Hulk.
This is the Marvel Tribe, brought to you by Walt's Apartment Podcast and the Diz Insider.
Avengers!
Assemble.
All right. Well, hey, ladies and gentlemen.
Special live of the Marvel Tribe.
Absolutely. So we are going to talk about what, in my opinion, is probably one of the best culmination of episodes ever produced by Marvel. And we can definitely get into that. But first, let's make our introductions. I mean, I am the co-host, Blurred Hulk, with the Disney podcast princess, Sam, who doesn't like us saying her last name on air. So we'll just say Sam. How are you doing, Sam?
I'm good. Sorry, we are a couple minutes late. Sam converted time zones incorrectly. But we're here and we're ready to talk about. I agree with you, David. This episode made my brain spin in every direction. And the end, I just sat there with my mouth open. Like, where do we go from here?
The end sabotaged everything. It made a reset. Everyone who is a rabbit hole, a theorist, speculator, the end just said, nope. Just like that. So while
and we've had a hard time. My delay. Am I super delayed?
No, you're fine. You're good.
Okay. So Marvel did so much with this. And the thing is, we've struggled to speculate on Loki in general since season one. I mean, we come up with what we would like to see, what we think they could do, but we've not had like any idea where they're going because this is all brand new material. It's not coming from another canon source.
Nope. You're right. Yeah. This is what I'm going to say. First of all, spoilers because Loki just came out the other day. So if you haven't seen it, don't be watching this live. Because we are definitely going to be talking about what just went down and stuff. So catch it on the, you can definitely stream us on the podcast, download this episode later, and then, go watch it and then come back and consume this content. But you've been warned. So with that said, I have to say RIP to the entirety of the MCU multiverse. It blew me away.
How much of Jonathan Majors do you think played into that scene, that ending scene with Victor? How much of that do you think it was to recast Jonathan Majors as King the Conqueror?
I thought about that. I really did give that some thought, and I really think this has nothing to do with this, with that. It more has to do with Kevin Feige having one big trick under his sleeve. And he found a villainous character who's multifaceted. Granted, he's coming towards the end of whatever he's dealing with, but he found a person that he could really do some amazing things with and kind of ruffle some feathers through the Marvel Universe with this character. I mean, we literally have, and most people don't realize this, like, people thought, like, Thanos was the butcher because, you know, one snap, he killed trillions and trillions. I mean, he killed half of all life, right?
Yes.
Well, pruning a timeline killed all of life, and he's killed trillions to the trillionth power. I mean, this guy, if you're doing body counts, nobody's hanging with King the Conqueror, so... He's truly the big baddie that is coming into
that is play why here. He is he who remains. Cause when at the end of time, it's going to be Kang. You're not gonna like to destroy him, can you?
Yeah.
No.
No, no. In fact, a guy is very comfortable in his death because he put I mean, when you control the timeline like that, you're literally a god. I mean, he set things in motion to pluck this Victor Timely, who is a variant of himself, off of the sacred timeline. So that means that he who remains knew, regardless of what he said. That dude lied. He knew what was going on. He had a plan. That dude is playing 4D chess. With all of these characters.
And that is why we're getting those chess references with Miss Minute.
Yeah. Yeah.
Also, my thought was that he who remains at the, you know, one that we've met before in the last season, knows his variants are going to try. Yeah. Maybe his variants are all good. Maybe he knows that they're going to stop him or that there are variants that can stop him. They can reverse whatever he does. So he is sending information back through Miss Minutes from He Who Remains at the End of Time to stop them from stopping him. Because maybe the only person who can stop King the Conqueror is King the Conqueror.
Yeah. I mean, that's kind of what that's kind of leading up to. I agree. I think we're talking someone whose genius level is that on Reed Richards scale. So this is what I really loved about this episode is that we're seeing things unfold that we weren't really expecting to happen, and it really kind of makes you kind of really think about how much of we saw glimpses of personalities that we see through all the kings and stuff. Like, they really are kind of loners, right? They are kind of tricksters, you know. I mean, Loki can respect that. That dude is a scam artist no matter what. So you'll know what is true and what isn't true and stuff. Yeah. So he's definitely operating on a different level of scheming and stuff. So he knows himself. So it has to be himself who has to defeat himself, and I feel like we're talking in a paradox here, but we kind of are. That's just kind of how this is.
Also, I just want to say, Miss Minutes, I want to smash her clock face in repeatedly.
So, I can I flesh out one of my theories that I really didn't get to in that little mini side quest thing I did. Miss Minutes, and I should have been more direct when I said this. I think Miss Minutes has a variant, and Miss Minutes' variant is Lila, who is the little who is the also a sentient AI in Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse. She works at the, you know, at the Hall of the Spider-Mans, helping them make sure canon events take place, or else because it's going to cause trouble in the timeline. Sounds familiar, right? AI who's sentient, who does that?
Who works on the timeline? Sure.
Yeah. Yeah. Pretty darn sure that Miss Minute has a variant. And that variant is absolutely Lila. So I just want to kind of put that out there and let people kind of chew on that, because it's not that theory isn't really out there like that. So
you heard it here. On the Marvel Tribe with the Blurred Hulk. I absolutely love that theory. Didn't even fathom Miss Minutes having a variant. I heard this entire episode. I just sat there and I was like, what a see you next Tuesday Everything was so self-serving, so manipulative. I was so angry. Mm-hmm. So angry watching her.
Well, look at what... Okay, so it opens up with, obviously, so, you know, we get the title card opening, and it goes straight to the end of time where Miss Minutes and Renslayer have been sent by Sylvie. And we got left on the cliffhanger of the last episode of, I have a secret to tell you about He Who Remains, and you're not going to like it. So Miss Minutes, being the manipulative you-know-what, decides, you know, she's going to show Ravonna what the secret is. And so she plays this clip, a little miniaturized clip for Ravonna, where it's Renslayer and He Who Remains sitting at the end of time, and they're in the throne room, and he is thanking her for being on his side, helping him win the army. They're talking about how, you know, we're going to rule everything forever. And she says always, and she can for see she time. Has this kind of evil for all times.
And he says always.
Yeah, he said always.
He says always later.
Yeah. And he had this kind of like, really, you can tell like that was a very uncomfortable thing that she was saying. So that's why there's nodes of that selfishness, like that psychopathy, narcissistic thing in him. Like, oh, she's talking about we. Nah, this is me. This is all me. So he sent her back to the TVA, and she is like, are you coming? He's like, yeah, I'll catch up. And then in comes Miss Minutes. This is why I thought Renslayer should have been pissed off at Miss Minutes too, because he's like, execute protocol 42, which means wipes everybody in the TVA's mind. So if I was Renslayer, I don't know about you, but if I was Renslayer and she played that, and I'm like, oh, I'm supposed to be just mad at the dead guy? You helped that. You wiped my mind. So I don't know what you think, but I would
Renslayer. Renslayer has a trauma bond. Renslayer has a trauma bond to Miss Minutes. That's literally the only person she has left. Nobody else giving her information. Plus, who has been taking care of her and giving her information to help her run the TVA this entire time? Miss Minutes. Yep. I feel like she has this trauma bond where she's so reliant upon her that it probably didn't even connect that, hey, this is like abuse.
No, you're right. Actually, I didn't think about that. That's actually a good point. They are tied through trauma. So she would have those blurred goggles on when it comes to Miss Minutes doing evil stuff, because she's doing it for her behalf at this point in time, right?
Yes. Plus, I mean, why wasn't she mad when she got there and got back there and was like, you just cut me off the boat and you let him do it? Like, well, you told him to do it. Yeah. Like, you encouraged it. Miss Minutes is weird. Such a weirdo. Talk about your AI sadistic. Falling in love with you.
Yeah. She is sadistic and red flags dropping everywhere for anyone that's around her. I mean, they need to be like, I'm not kicking it with you. I'm good. But yeah. I have to say, so tell me, did you, or maybe it was just me, when Victor Timely finally enters the TVA in the war room where his big head statue's in the background and he's now there, he's in the TVA. I had a big like, yes, like this is like, I shouldn't be cheering on because he's a villain-ish. But
it's like daddy came home.
Yeah, dude's home. Like, oh, it's about to ramp up.
But surprisingly, it wasn't. He kept his integrity. That variant kept his integrity. I mean, we don't know what was going to happen when he got, you know, out to put the Thoroshare piece in, but he at least was going to attempt it knowing he could die, unless he sent himself as a variant to die to further along some other kind of plan. But I want to go with he had it. I want to go with he had integrity because it'll make my heart happier.
So I like that. And obviously, we'll find out in the next episode. But I think this was all part of He Who Remains plan. Like, this really, like, oh my, like, yeah. And we can definitely, we'll get into that part and stuff. But I love how he was just wandering. Go ahead.
The finale, we'll get more into it. But that final scene, they could have ended a season with that. They could have ended a season with that. And I would have been salivating for more for the next year. Like, I would have been begging. God. That scene, this episode was incredible. The storytelling was incredible. The the filmography of the scenes running down the hallway when Miss Minutes is, like, keeping Sylvie and Loki apart. Just the drama in those scenes, the lighting, everything was so perfect. And then that at the end, there's just this beautiful cut to black when everything is sucked into a giant black hole and everything is gone.
They soprano us. That's what
cuts to blackness. And I'm like,
that's how they ended The Sopranos. And some people loved it because you never knew what happened with the Tony Soprano's family or anything in the diner. It just went to black. And some people hated it. I was part of the party that hated that. If they would have ended that season of it just cutting to black on Loki's face as the light, just I would have lost my shit. So
the difference with The Sopranos going out like that and Loki going out like that is they can play out this, whatever the ending is, the end of time with Loki's story, literally anywhere else in the MCU. So we were going to get further answers regardless.
Yeah.
The Sopranos, that obviously that what there was no multiverse going on or anything. So it was just the end. But no. I loved that scene. And it made my jaw drop and I panicked. I panicked, but in a good way.
Yeah, no. Same. My jaw dropped. It took me a minute to collect myself because I just literally just we just witnessed as far as we know, the little bit of information we know about the timelines and everything else, we just witnessed existence just
get sucked out of. Yeah, it's gone.
Yeah, just gone. And we watched Loki, Tom Hiddleston, that dude, I had to rewatch it because he didn't say anything. It was all facial expressions, and it said a million words right there. We saw the despair. We saw a God who isn't afraid of really anything, just felt defeated. Like, he went through all emotions and reality. Like, it really was like the end for him, and his jaw dropped and everything. And we're just watching him act this out and stuff and feeling the same thing he was, like, what the hell? That came out of, that's not how this is supposed to end. All of this work, this is how this, so yeah, kudos to him. Hiddleston, dude, you should get an Oscar just for this episode alone. That was awesome.
I also love the way that this episode gave us, so before destroying everything, because we have no idea what's to come. We don't know who's going to still exist. We don't know how they're going. We know nothing. Zero idea. It gave us some more intimate moments with some of the people we haven't gotten to know much. Like, we got more time with B5 Brad. We got to see more with Docs and B15.
General Docs.
So getting all of these smaller intimate moments, not only did it reconnect you to the storyline and give you hope and make you, like, it was such a pull back and forth. It was like, yes, there's hope for the TVA. And then it's like, oh shit, the bad guys are here. And then, yes, there's hope still. No, it's bad again. It was this back and forth the entire episode.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Brilliantly written.
One of my favorite parts of this episode was the meeting of Ouroboros and Victor Timely. Like, when Sylvie, Loki, and Mobius found Victor and they escorted him to the engineering room where Ouroboros was working on fixing the loom, and then they meet And he talked of, like, for a second, like that moment of like, wait, what was your name again? Victor? Wait, what? Like,
yeah. And but who did, whose ideas are these?
Yeah.
We don't know.
It's a chicken before the egg. This is the iconic what came first, because Victor Timely based his entire life work off of that TVA handbook, which is authored by Ouroboros. Ouroboros wrote and designed everything in the TVA based off of the 19th century inventor
Victor Timely.
And we're in this space where we're outside of the timeline. So it really is that paradoxical chicken or the egg. What came first and stuff? And so I love, and then I asked for each other's autographs, and they were fanboying out over each other. That was kind of cool.
So then that takes me back to where we, you know, started the episode, and or in the last episode, actually, when we see that Ravona Renslayer drops the book to the tiny little Victor. And that's because Miss Minute told her that that's what He Who Remains wanted. Like, what, like, who actually, like, did He Who Remains actually charge this? Did Miss Minutes do this because he's gone and she's trying to get him back?
So I did go through that thought process of, if is this really a like a master scheme of Miss Minutes, or is this He Who Remains? I really believe it's He Who Remains.
Because Miss Minutes is obsessed.
She is. She's obsessed,
and she keeps at that last sign or the last time that she saw him. She's like, "You'll never be him."
She's unstable. Yeah, like I really thought she was going to boil a bunny rabbit. Like she was that crazy. Like I was getting Basic Instinct vibes from an AI sentient being. So
who is allowed to have her own free will?
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely.
And there was something about that scene, though. I'm going to go with it's Miss Minutes, because there's something about that last scene. Like, she's so jealous with all the variants, like, doesn't have that connection to them. And because Ravona does, or because someone else or something else does, she wants that direct attention from her creator. And that last scene, well, not one of the last scene, but one of the last scenes when she's being powered down so that they can shut down the security systems in the TVA, she goes, "You'll never be him." Like, I was going to sacrifice you anyways, because you'll never be him. Or like, I don't know. I feel like Miss Minutes has a bigger role to play than He Who Remains at this point. And I think that if something were to happen with the variants, then she never gets him back. So that's why she's like trying to bring all of them in or something like that. I don't know. Well, yeah, I've got to flesh it out somewhere.
Yeah, well, I think she came to a realization through Ravona that they don't need He Who Remains. So that's why
she's psycho obsessed.
You're never going to be, you're not going to be him. You're never going to be that person. This was, and I really do think that was a reaction to He Who Remains' plan. I mean, in fact, so here's my thought process on this. Here, He Who Remains planted variants of himself throughout the sacred timeline. They have no clue that they are King variants. That's why they're just living out their little lies. You know, like little Victor Timely, as we saw, he was pouring wax into a candle and stuff, because he's like a candle maker and stuff, right? He didn't start creating a new timeline until he got that book, because when they fast forward to when Victor was older, it created a new branch timeline. So I think He Who Remained knew his end was coming. So he planted multiple variants of himself on the sacred timeline without them knowing about it. They just exist. Some are going to live and just die. Some are going to be, or one or two may be activated, like Victor Timely. And I think Victor Timely was the plan that he told, you know, this is him playing chess, right? He told, Miss Minutes to get Renslayer to do this mission to get Victor into the TVA to basically become the new He Who Remains at the end of all time, right? And then we get this ending, like, boom. That's my theory is dead. Like, I don't know if this was a failed plan or if this was supposed to happen. Like, this is all part of him playing 4D chess. Like, this, he got Victor. He set up Sylvie. He set up Loki. Like, those two are the crucial crutch to everything, right? There's more superheroes and stuff, right, out there in the universe. So why is Loki and Sylvie so special? They plucked Sylvie when she was a kid. I think he knew that Sylvie had to kill him. Like, this is all part of his plan. Everything that led up to the blanking of everything at the end was part of his plan. I don't know how. I don't know what it means. This is the first time where I'm out of theories, and I don't know what's coming next, which I'm excited for.
Yeah, but to be in the mind of Kevin Feige, like, I want to live in there. It would be like endless creativity. No, we would never sleep or eat or shower.
I think it would be exciting and torturous to be in one of those think tank rooms in Marvel Studio when they're creating all of these storyboards and stuff. I couldn't help myself. Like, I would just be in awe listening and horrified at the same time for the stuff they want to do and the stuff that they just dish off. Like, no, we're not doing this. Like, it's to be in the presence of him and his cohorts of Marvel experts just storyboarding the entire phases and everything and stuff and how everything ties. That would just blow my mind and scare me all at the same time.
Yeah, it would be a lot. Is there anything? Do you want to dissect some more scene by scene? So
let's talk about the so we have General Vox and her merry men of hunters all locked up and arrested, right? Obviously, they tried to prune all the timelines because that's all they know how to do. That's all they're programmed to do. They thought they're doing the right thing. So they're in jail. The judge came to B-15 and said, hey, look, at one point in time, I thought the TVA way was the only way. You're the one who convinced me. You're going to have to convince her, right? So she goes to go talk to General Docs. And, you know, it's kind of funny because Docs is sitting in the middle of the room. All of her soldiers are like in the timeout corner of the room. Mm-hmm. She's sitting in the middle. Mind you, on top of that box of, you know, that box that they use to crush, you know, mm-hmm. Things. So B-15 goes in to talk to her. And I'm gonna be honest. I think she gave her something to chew on, and she almost kind of convinced her, like, let's figure out a new way we can keep work and save the TVA mm-hmm. together, and do what, you know, what we need to do.
This is what we were trained to do. Yeah, programmed right, to do.
Yeah, she wasn't like, you're not my enemy. I have to do this because we're trying to slow everything down, and you're like steadily destroying trillions and trillions of timelines and stuff and people. So we want to work with you. I mean, we understand how, I know how you are. You know how I am. I'm not lying to you. I really do.
They're both loyalists.
We're both loyalists, and we're both in a new timeline. I mean, a new way. We need to take a moment and figure this out together. So I think she was going to come around. So after she left, in comes Ravonna Renslayer with her demand, Miss Minutes, and saying, hey, basically, bottom line, I'm taking back the TVA. I leave for a few days and it's gone to shit. You're either with me or you're not. You're against me. If you're with me, hey, guess what? I'll reward you with a sweet life like Brad over there on the timeline and call it good. Help me out. If not, hey, rest in peace, right?
Docs was like, no, ma'am, we are not going to do that. Like, you are a traitor. You are an enemy of the TVA. She remained in her loyalist ways. So Miss Minutes did her.
And Miss Minutes was so happy to jump into that freaking machine to turn that machine on.
The boxes.
Oh yeah.
She's so witchy. Perfect for Halloween season. And, you know, puts them all in the box, and Brad does not end up in a box because Brad cares more about being a actor who's going to fall from fame in 2 months to
You know what Brad remind me of?
What?
So you remember the character? You've seen, I'm assuming you've seen The Matrix, right?
Yes.
So you remember the character, the guy who betrays everyone because he's tired of eating goop and there. He just wants to be put back into the Matrix. He wants to be rich. He wants to not remember. That's who Brad reminds me of, is that guy. The guy who was like, yes, I will help you guys win if I can have my life back and stuff. I don't care what damage it does. I mean, I'm like, bar for bar, he is a reincarnation of that guy. Like,
yeah. Yeah, Brad is like, so, just get me back to my limousine. I love that Mobius told him, you're going to fall from fame in 2 months anyways. So
yeah. rate this death scene, because I'm going to be honest, of all the death scenes of every movie in Marvel, this is probably the most gruesome death scene I've ever
seen. And you see nothing.
Yes, they all got put in the box. This was some serial killer morbid stuff. Like they weren't just dying from the force field of the body. They were crushing into each other. They were killing each other.
Be turned into smush.
The
sound effects.
Oh my God. Yeah. This was hands down the worst murdering ever in the Marvel Cinematic Universe I've ever not witnessed.
What about the decapitation?
Even that, I'm sorry, but I rather you, because decapitation, I means I'm dead a half a second. They slowly, as the box shrunk and they like squished into each other,
and you hear as their organs and guts oozing.
Way worse than decapitate me. Absolutely. Like, it's, you know, I probably won't even feel it before my head hits the ground. That, they felt that. Every squishing little minute second until they were sludge. Like, so I defy anybody out there to tell me there's a worse death scene. That,
and by Brad's face was everything. Because he
couldn't even look. He could barely look.
Oh, like, and you.
And
like,
when he didn't eat, girl.
No. I agree. That scene, horrendous.
So, yeah. So X5 decided to be a betrayer and join Renslayer and Miss Minutes, and
X5 Brad.
So
works out. He ends up being a great tool later on in the episode, though.
Oh, I love that. Oh, man. Like, okay, so we get to the point where, Mobius, Loki, Sylvie, and, you know, we have OB and Victor. They're all in the room. They're working on the loom and testing things out. And so they're like, all right, well, we're going to let you guys get back to it and work. And let's go have some pie. This pissed off Sylvie to no end. Like, are you serious?
Sylvie, though, like, she's not wrong. Like, I'm going back to her Love is a Dagger scene. Like, when she starts speaking, she knows what's up. Like, she called Mobius out and told him, like, literally everything around us is being destroyed and you care about pie. This is just another day at the office for you. You didn't want to go find out if any of your timelines had been killed, if any variants of you have been killed. And at this point, this is probably why Mobius hasn't gotten a jet ski, because he's letting all of his timelines with jet skis get killed off.
So, okay, I hear what you're saying. And you and I, last season, we disagreed on Sylvie. You love Sylvie. Sylvie's a villain. And she's the one. I mean, I'm going to be honest. That the end scene is her fault. Everything she did, from the stabbing, set all this in motion. So technically, all the if we had to assign blame for who's all these trillions to the trillion power multiverses that are apparently gone, whose blood who's on whose hands? It's all on Sylvie's hands.
Unless it was orchestrated for Sylvie to be there. Sylvie still had free will.
She could have listened to Loki and not killed Hilly Huber remains.
You know what's amazing? We are now saying listen to Loki when at any other point in the MCU, we never would have said that.
No, he's a trickster god. Why would anyone listen to Loki? So I get what you're saying. Yes, this is facts. But in this case, listen to Loki.
No, so. I agree. I love the moral compass change that we're seeing in Loki. And I hope it's here to stay, but I also hope we get a variant that brings back his mischief.
Yeah. I mean, we got a very much a Captain America speech from Loki in the pie room to Sylvie. Like, it was inspirational. Like, hold on to hope. I almost felt like we're, you know, talking to President Loki Obama. Like, it was like hope and dreams and this and that. And he was doing the inspiring, like, but he was believing it. Like, it was, I was like, wow, Loki did a 180. This is not the same Loki, you know, that we've known to hate and love. So
no, so
and he convinced Sylvie a little bit. So
he did, and he convinces. So Sylvie and Loki, they keep giving in to each other, and like when he calls her soft, like I don't know, maybe her moral compass is giving him moral compass too, or vice versa. I don't know, but maybe they're each other's hope.
It might be good. So here's my little theory. I think if Loki left to their own devices by themselves, they're disastrous. You know, they're doomed to always fail and repeat themselves. But when Lokis are together, like Sylvie and our prime Loki here, they can break their chain, their generational trauma bonds, and of, you know, they can do good. And we're seeing that. So they kind of need each other to be this complete god. I was about to say human being, but they're not humans.
No, Loki very person. Loki says we are gods. She said, are you just going to keep trying to play God? And he goes, we are gods. I loved that part.
He accepted it. Yes, we are gods. Literally, they are gods. So
after that speech, you know, we get all the chaos with Renslayer, and then Mobius comes back with hot chocolate. And talks about how it came from a hot chocolate machine. So, of course, you say
the nerdiest thing ever.
And Victor's got to go. So Victor got escorted. And that is how he gets captured by X5.
Taken
to Renslayer.
Yep. So D90, the one who pruned... The D90 is the one who pruned Mobius in season one. He got pruned himself by X5, which I'm going to be honest. I thought, tell me for a fleeting second, when Victor gave
I thought it was D90, Victor, yeah.
I did too. I was like, wait, did he program
that machine to prune people?
Yeah, I was like, no way, he's a super genius. But then we find out it was X5 who pruned him and took Victor.
That kind of added to the innocence factor of Victor, It did. Again, that kind of like, oh, did that happen? Oh, no, good. There's still hope. Oh, nope. Now he's taken by Renslayer. What? Miss Minutes. His two scorned lovers.
Yeah. So we got a cliffhanger answered for us from the very first episode of Who Pruned Loki? Because it showed Loki with that little loom indicator thing, like it was a different dressed Loki looking around, and you hear the phone ring. We see the fact that Miss Minutes trapped Sylvie in the elevator and stuff, and basically Miss Minutes was just taking over the TVA, locking people out, everything. And so we hear the phone rings, we see Loki looking at the phone, and then he gets pruned because we see the other Loki who's trying to find Sylvie, prune him. Sylvie witnessed it, and he's like, I'll explain later.
No, he says, you'll believe it later or something like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Or it'll make sense later. It'll make sense. It'll make sense. It will make sense. But you notice he didn't say that to Loki. He said it to us.
Mm-hmm.
The direction of his head changes. He is talking to the audience. It will make sense later.
I thought it made pretty good sense now. Like, I understood it. I know Sylvie didn't. That was weird to open the door and then watch the guy you're trying to catch a Renslayer with get pruned in front of you. And then you see him right behind. Like, it's like, did I just watch a Loki prune a Loki? Like, what? Yeah. So, and then the phone ring. That was the other mystery. Like, who was calling? It was Obi. Which is weird. He's like, dude, you need to get down here. Like, we need to find Miss Minutes is locking everyone out and everything else. I mean, and then he came up on the fly like, well, if we reset, the TVA, it could take her out. But the thing is, the people who have magical powers will get their powers back, and they both shout, do it now.
They can now use their powers in the TVA, unfortunately, it didn't appear to make a difference, at least with what we saw. We don't know what the end game is here, so it could very well make sense after.
I have no clue what next episode is going to be, because none of this, I mean, we literally got a season ending like finale. And we have no clue. Like, we know we got a couple more episodes. We just don't know what direction they're going to because of what happened at the end of this one.
Yeah, they have a blank canvas for pretty much the entire MCU at this point.
Mm-hmm.
Timelines, multiverse, it's all whatever you want to do, variants. MCU just gave itself a blank timeline.
Oh, yeah. I do love how Sylvie got some payback on Renslayer. Because she possessed X5, and X5 did a pretty good job acting out a character when he walked back into that war room. He saw Victor Timely, and then he grabs Renslayer. He's like, "Come with me, come here." Like, "Oh, hey, yeah," and stab. You get pruned. Like, that was just really
kind of so goofy.
A nice little payback. It was goofy. I can just imagine a Sylvie in the corner just kind of being all giddy that she got her upcoming. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And I'm glad to see Renslayer gone, because I'm done. And Miss Minute, maybe Miss Minute's gone because the TVA is never going to be rebuilt. Maybe that system is never going to be rebooted. Maybe we're done with Miss Minutes.
So tell me what you think about this interaction. So when they were resetting things and Miss Minute did the whole, like, you'll never be him.
Mm-hmm.
I think that really kind of cut like Victor kind of deeply and stuff. Like, you're never going to be living up to this. I think that's the reason why Victor put on the suit. He's like, I can be your hero. I can save the TVA. This is my work. And that was, I think that was a setup. I think she said that. And because King's he protects himself. Why would he ever put himself in danger, knowing he's not a dumb guy and stuff?
But wasn't that why he didn't want? He wasn't going to be killed, because if he's killed, then that's how we got the variants. So I don't know.
So I think he wanted to be the hero, and he thought this was going to play out the way he thought. So he suited up, and he's like, this has to be me. I got to be the, so I am going to live up to the, screw Miss Minutes and what she said to me. I'm going to live up to this. And so he goes out, and when they open the doors,
spontaneous
spaghettification.
I'm like, not going to lie. That was a rough death scene too.
You saw, like, I slowed mode that. I saw you see his ribs, you see a skeleton, you see everything get spaghettified. Like, I was like, and it shocked me. I'm like, wait,
I guess
this ain't supposed to happen this way. This, wait, what?
So it was one of those, it was like, yay, you have hope. And you literally got yanked immediately. Yep. There's a little bit of hope. Yep. Yank. That was this entire episode. It was a complete, like, brain F.
Out of predictability, I was expecting him to go out there, the time, you know, like him, he's fighting against the clock. You know, he drops part of the machine, or he has to figure it out on the fly. Like, there's this whole, like, that's how shows work, right? There's this culmination of this buildup. No, we got robbed of that instantly. As soon as he walked out there, boom, dead. Yeah, just like you said, like, jaw hit the floor. What the freak?
I just realized we didn't share this live out to anything except for the original, our main Facebook page.
Oh, are you serious? I told you I don't know what I'm doing.
It's okay. And
I just realized we have like no...
We've no been talking viewer. For how long? All right. Hang on, I got it. It's fine.
Still just record it, right?
Yeah. Yeah, we still have access to it. I just shared it out. It's so funny because we just
been for 45 minutes just
talking to ourselves.
Yep. Well, so, hey, I'm okay.
If you're just joining right now on any of the video platforms, you can go back and replay because that was a faux pas on our part. But go listen to the recording.
So, spoiler alert for all those who are brand new joining us. We've been talking about for the past 45 minutes, Loki and the arc and how everything is going. So,
if you haven't seen the latest episode and you're going to be upset with spoilers, this is not the place for you. So,
Yep. Do not watch this. Do not tune in. When talking about Loki, and we're going to continue we're basically almost wrapping up.
Yeah, we forgot to share to all of our sites, so go back and watch the replay. That's okay. Go back and watch.
So, and you're going to want to. We actually talked. There's some really good stuff that we talked about and stuff. So you want to stream and watch or listen to the podcast and just download it if you missed it, which you did because I didn't share this out to everybody. So don't watch. We'll just finish up here. So predictions. Let's talk about some predictions.
Make sure we share out the recording to all of the sites. It's pretty funny.
Yeah. Okay. Yep. My bad.
Predictions.
That's me.
Predictions.
Yeah.
It's wide open. Nothing. Nothing. I don't even know what I want. That's how wide open it is. I don't even know what I want to see at this point.
So. I don't know what I want to see. They can go so many ways. I mean, obviously there's other realms when people die. I mean, they just exist. Loki could go to hell and go meet his sister Hela and have a conversation and maybe get brought. I don't know, because there's nothing, like, as far as we know, The multiverse is gone. Like, it's...
Well, I mean, technically... Well, I guess he couldn't because he's not... Can Loki go to Valhalla if he dies in battle?
He's not a true Asgardian.
That's why I was like, does it work that way?
But in the MCU, if they let Jane go...
They let Jane.
So he would qualify then. I mean, he's as... more of an Asgardian than she is, so.
And he's technically was in a battle.
Yeah, trying to save all of the existence of mankind, alien kind, species kind.
So I would say instead of going to see Hela, he might be going to see Odin, because they did make have a nod to Odin in this episode.
Oh yeah, oh yes, and. This is the first time I don't really have a theory. I don't know what I want to see. I don't know what's going to happen. There's nothing that, I mean, it literally just ended, severed all of my rabbit hole connections and stuff. So this next episode is going to be fresh eyes. I don't have expectations or anything. I'm just excited to see what's about to unfold.
Pure excitement, faith in Kevin Feige. And trust in the MCU. to take whatever blank canvas that they just gave themselves and make it something absolutely incredible.
Yep. Yeah.
Hi, Bill.
At this point in time, that's literally all we can do. I've never seen somebody so cleanly severed so many people's theories. It's just like, nope, all wrong. Boom, 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 boom.
Literally complete starting fresh. Yeah. Like I said, even the writing in this entire episode was such a whirlwind because you had that constant, like, there's struggle and then there's hope and there's struggle and there's hope. And it was literally every 2 to 3 minutes you were being yanked in another direction.
Yep.
And then just those like the graphic nature of the murder scenes, those last two scenes where you see him get spaghetti strapped, whatever you called him earlier.
Spaghetti-fied.
And then the cut to black.
Yeah.
Incredible.
So we have YouTube user Kevin saying Loki will get renewed season 3. No, I know that. That's not going to happen. Actually, Kevin Feige actually said that's not going to happen. So what we do know is that this season is going to inform Deadpool 3 and some of the other upcoming movies and stuff. But there is no talks or plans for a renewal of this season. So if that is,
that's why they're giving themselves news. That's why they're giving themselves this blank canvas, because they used Loki to do what they needed him to do, like his character. The MCU just got a blank canvas. Mm-hmm. They can literally change anything they want right now because time doesn't exist.
I mean, it's crazy. It's literally, Loki just Ragnarok the entire MCU multiverse. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was destined to do that because the Lokis are destined to fail. Again, this is why Sylvie is a villain, because she didn't have to stab He Who Remains, but she did anyway. And here we are. Thank you, Sylvie.
You're such...
I mean, yeah, it could have been missed minutes, and this is part of He Who Remains plan this whole time, but Sylvie didn't have to be a pawn in that plan, so...
The Marvel's box office total run prediction, $750 to $850.
Dollars? That's kind of low.
I think we're I hope we're going at least the here.
I'll be honest, I don't see it hitting a billion, but I definitely see it hitting higher. It's been a while, and I say that, like, it's been a while since we have like a big feature like Marvel on the big screen, like
Guardians 3, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. And we're kind of in a new era. Like, we have short-term memory. So you give us a few months, it's a reset. So,
yeah.
And people are getting out there in the theaters more. We're seeing that. We saw that with Barbie and Oppenheimer, and people aren't afraid of theaters as much. So we may see. And it's coming out during this Christmas season, which fourth quarter is a really good.
So is it November
10th? Yeah, November 10th.
So if you're going to, everyone go watch it. If you are a Marvel fan, go support it in theaters. That is a great way to contribute to getting more things done in the future. Not that Marvel needs.
And I'll be honest, it looks like
maybe they'll pay their actors better.
Yeah, looks like it's a fun, campy kind of Guardian of the Galaxy kind of style, which I love. I mean, it's kind of my favorite.
And we get endings, or we get we get some connections to Secret Invasion, most likely. We get connections to WandaVision. We get connections to Ms. Marvel.
Doctor Strange. We get, yes, Ms. Marvel, all those. So, yeah.
It's connecting all of the things we've been consuming on Disney Plus.
So, I definitely say go see it. It's definitely going to be a big. I think it's going to be a box office hit. I don't know if it's going to crack a billion. I think at this point in time, no one really knows, but I think it's not going to flop.
I'm going to go 990. I'm going to go 997 million.
997? All right. I'll go 998. $1 really? More. $1 so more. So, oh, yeah, no, I think it's going to do good. I think it will. There's always those who are going to say it's flop, but they haven't seen it. These are when people tell you something's going to be bad and they haven't seen it, that's when you stop listening to them. Just close your ears and walk away. Like, okay, unless you're a psychic or you've been to the future and on some point in the timeline, you have no freaking clue what this is going to do. I mean, the same people who said Barbie is too woke, it's going to flop, it's not even going to break 50 million. $1 billion later, those people are pretty quiet.
I was not a fan of that movie, and I was vocal.
Hey, most people are. My wife actually wasn't a fan of Barbie, but it still made $1 billion and stuff. So
I know, and that's no. A lot of people loved the movie, and I was like, but this. Yeah. If you want a review of that, go check out my Facebook page. Scroll down for a couple of months; it's in there somewhere. but yeah, I think that does that about all we have for.
Yeah, I have no predictions of what we're going to see. I mean, I want to see Loki. I think we're going to see Loki. I just don't know what that looks like.
I have no idea either. I am looking to see if we have our ending in here. Oh, play at the end. Nope. I got it. All right. Yeah. So that's all that we have tonight for the Marvel Tribe. Thanks for joining us in this live. Sorry we didn't share it out sooner. We were a little confused. But check us out. Stop. Make sure you're checking us out on all podcast platforms. Check us out on all of our other social media, Walt's Apartment Podcast, and join us on Patreon. And we'll see you later.
Peace. Marvel Tribe.